All right. So it's quite nice that I had a cover page already. I didn't realize that. So I'm just going to get right into it. So I just have a really quick little table of contents so you guys have an idea of where I'm going with this. So I'm going to first explain, what does a remote sensing scientist do? What do I do? But also, why is it important to study hydrology specifically for water resources? And how can satellites be used for studying hydrology? More specifically, how can radar satellites, the new satellites that are being launched, how can these be used for measuring, for assessing hydrology? I'm going to talk really briefly about a brief overview about the SWOT mission, the Sentinel-6 mission, and NISAR, and some precursor research that I've done in preparation for the recently launched surface water and ocean topography mission. So what can we learn from studying the airborne Ka-band radar? But also, since this is meant to reach out to a lot of students, I wanted to give you a really brief overview about how you can actually get involved in remote sensing research. So, what does a remote sensing scientist and engineer do? So part of what I do is actually develop new systems. So I do field work. I do field work probably between 10% to 20% of the time. And actually, because of COVID, I just didn't do any field work at all for a while. So I design instruments and collect data. So I have this little schematic there. I don't need a clicker for that. I have a schematic. I build it in the office, and then I take it out into the field. So this is an example of me in Canada. But I also fly UAVs, so this is a really nice drone photo. So part of the work that I do studies really vast areas that are really difficult to reach. We can't do a field measurement in every little spot. And also, the area is extremely heterogeneous, so we can't really collect enough point-based measurements to get an assessment of what's happening in a broader scale. So we need a larger scale assessment of what's happening. But what is remote sensing? So the satellite remote sensing is a relatively new field, and actually some of the work that a lot of the researchers in this room already do is some form of remote sensing. That is, they're using the electromagnetic spectrum to analyze various scale features. But satellite remote sensing is relatively new, with new satellites that have been launched since the 1970s that enables a broad scale regional and global studies of local phenomena. So if I wanted to know, you know, how tall is this tree? I can do that, but I can do that from space, and I can measure all of the trees in the world from space. So I can measure all of the lakes in the world and all the buildings in the world from space. And so we use satellites, airplanes, UAVs, submarines, and all of these different devices to measure subsurface, surface, and even atmospheric phenomena from space. So what are the processes of remote sensing? This is kind of a large circle, and a lot of people work on either one section of it, or you might work on the entire life cycle. So part of it that a lot of people think of is just mapping and algorithm development. That is, I have a map and I'm trying to extract information out. So there we're analyzing data collected from the instrument to retrieve the information of interest. So again, if I have a map and I want to know how tall is the tree, then I need to develop a retrieval algorithm to estimate how tall is the tree. The next part is a longer term monitoring and modeling. So we take a time series of that same information. We want to collect information to get a good assessment of how things are changing over time and over space. We use, and we're also building predictive models for that. Next, some people are interested in working on the assessment. So once you have that information, then how can you assess the feature of interest? And I'm being intentionally very broad because it depends on your specific research and your specific area of interest. And we want to identify how this feature or measurement is important. And finally, or even just solely, instrument development. So some of the work that I do is actually in preparation for launching a new satellite mission. So I'm on science teams where we're developing new satellites to be launched into space. But we have to identify the necessary instrument specifications in order to collect the data, and then also be responsive to the planned science objective. So we want to be able to identify what features needs to be measured and how do we develop the technologies in order to do that. So what do I do in my current role right now? I spend a lot of time reading papers. I spend a lot of time writing papers. I'm advising undergraduates right now. I'm submitting proposals for funding. I actually recently received funding, so I'm really excited. My very first proposal got accepted. And I'm collaborating to develop new satellite missions. So why is it important to study hydrology? I'm going to double check my time, actually. Yep, I'm good. Why is it important to study hydrology, specifically water resources? So I'm really interested in hydroclimatic disasters and natural disasters driven by hydrology. And we know that the global hydrologic cycle is changing in a warming climate. And so that leads to significant loss of life and damage to infrastructure. We have things such as landslides and flooding. This is a really nice schematic of the water cycle. But what we can see here is that warming systems influence terrestrial water fluxes. So again, we have the increase in warming, we have increased evaporation, we have a lot of water cycling through the system, and that's actually changing the way we understand what the water cycle is and what's happening at a regional scale. And so the way that I'm thinking about a lot of these problems is that it kind of fits two different poles. So we have one side where we have moisture excess and another side where we have moisture scarcity. So when you have too much water or moisture excess, that can cause things like flooding, it can cause things like landslides. If you have too little water, you can have issues such as wildfires or droughts. I'm also interested in other geomorphologic dynamics, such as monitoring floodplain changes. So again, with changes in water, changes in temperature, the floodplains can actually change. We have issues where houses might actually be falling into the river because the riverbank starts eroding away, as well as permafrost thaw and melting ice wedges. So how is the landscape actually changing under a changing climate? And it's really important to understand that surface water drives a lot of these processes. But we actually don't have a really great accounting of all of the surface water. We don't have a great accounting of how much there is, what it looks like, what's the shape of all of these lakes. Global lakes are really understudied due to extreme diverse size distribution. So there's some of the lakes that are way too small to look at, and there's some lakes that are way too big to look at using current technologies. 10% of the largest lakes make up around 80% of the global frozen, non-frozen freshwater. And around one quarter of the global lakes are in northern high latitudes. So most of my research has been mostly focused in Canada and Alaska so far. Global wetland distribution is also extremely important. This is the area of water we can't quite see as water because it's mixed in with vegetation. But this also has very important contributions to the carbon cycle, the lateral and atmospheric carbon fluxes, connectivity and habitat availability, and the connectivity of lakes and rivers. But it's, again, it's very important that we don't really have a good accounting of this. We have, we have permanent monitoring stations, but they're actually very sparse. And they tend to be in very rich countries or areas where that are able to develop this really dense network. This image is actually from 2016, so it's a slight underestimate of the current state of global monitoring networks. This is an example of precipitation stations. But again, you can see that there's a lot of areas in the world that are gray. That is, we don't have good coverage. So what are my overarching research questions? I'm really interested in how are global water resources changing under a changing climate, and what can that lead to in terms of monitoring natural disasters, and understanding what kind of information do we need in order to answer this question. So how can satellites be used in hydrology? So this is a schematic of NASA Earth Science missions through 2023. And again, this is kind of an older figure, so we're in 2023 right now. But you can see that we have quite a bit. You can't quite tell. This says SWOT here. So SWOT, the surface water and ocean topography, is the primary satellite that I'm really interested in working on. But we can see that Earth observing systems from NASA and NOAA, which basically means that it's become a more operational service. They're covering the globe. So we have a lot of satellite data. So one of the things that satellite data is capable of doing is actually measuring things like water quality, such as assessing chlorophyll content. We can also just look very broadly at surface color. So it depends on the wavelengths that you're looking at. But if you're standing outside and the water looks weird and you take a picture with your phone, it's kind of like that, but on a much larger scale. You can do this using satellite data with a lot more wavelengths and a lot more sensitivity. Because of that, we can also retrieve information such as surface temperature. But for a smaller lake perspective, we can see that studies have demonstrated a really high resolution tracking of water surface area and volume change. But again, because the lakes are so small, some of the information that we have, the tiles, the actual data that we have, comes in a very small little package. So it's very computationally intensive to be able to do this for the whole globe. So global studies are needed to do this test of assessing the much smaller water bodies for the globe. So one of the projects that I got involved in early before my PhD was assessing the flooding in the lower Mekong Delta. This is I really love this figure. I made it when I was like a first year remote sensing student. So this schematic basically shows a mosaic stacking of multiple dates of data that will enable us to track in very high temporal resolution the flooding extent that is happening here. So instead of having an assessment of what is the flood extent every week, we actually got that down to half a day. So we can see a very dynamic flood extent changes and be a little bit more responsive to areas that are in need of help. Another example that I worked on is to increase the spatial resolution of that. So instead of looking at the flood extent at 250 meter scales, we can now look at 30 meter scales. So this advancement allowed us to assess regional flooding at near real time, twice a day with 30 meter resolution. So again, that's a significant increase from it being 1 week and 30 meters, or sorry, 1 week and 250 meters. Another research, another research project that I worked on was monitoring landslides. And so this is a major landslide in Nepal. This is the Sankoshi landslide that happened in 2014. This claimed 156 lives. And it would not have happened if we had better prediction technology. So some of the work that I did was to develop wet surface, newly exposed soil algorithm to assess new landslides that occur that might not be reflected in the literature. That allows us to produce susceptibility models to do better landslide predictions. So we can catalog precipitation-induced landslides using automated detection methods and pinpoint the date of failure using optical imagery and precipitation data. Another research project that I worked on is on the global terrestrial water storage. So again, we have this big cycle of all of the water that's moving around, and what I'm really interested in for this is to have a really good accounting of the terrestrial water, so that's the surface water that you see, as well as the soil moisture, as well as the aquifers underneath. And so this actually got split into two projects. That's terrestrial water storage using satellite observations and hydrological models. And so we have this time series. This is the conventional way of understanding the water cycle, so it's precipitation, evaporation, and runoff, versus the terrestrial water storage from this new satellite that was launched called GRACE, the Gravity Recovery and Climate Experiment. And that's a really coarse resolution data. That's around 100 kilometer pixel sizes. So you actually can't do very much on a local scale. And so some of the work that I did was to develop a GRACE proxy. That's a 250 meter terrestrial water storage. So that allows us to get much better resolution, much more information about what's happening on a more local scale. Still good. So some of the terrestrial water storage for some basins, as I depicted here in the Amazon, is actually really easy to model. As I actually go back here, you can see that this cycle looks fairly predictable. It's just this really simple sinusoid. But other basins aren't that neat looking. So because other basins aren't so neat, it makes the prediction much harder. So a significant challenge in hydrology is assessing the terrestrial water storage. And that's sometimes described as the water budget. So it's our ability to account for how much water is in the atmosphere, how much water is in the land, how much water is in soil, in aquifers, and all of these different pieces. So two significant remaining sources of air, and they're not the only ones, but the two that I'm particularly focused on are surface water and soil moisture. And for this talk, I'm just gonna talk about surface water and the way that we can do that, the way that we can assess and quantify this using remote sensing. So I just mentioned a few different techniques using optical remote sensing methods, but not radar. I'm really into radar right now, so I'm gonna talk to you about radar. But what is radar? Radar is an acronym for radio detection and ranging. So a lot of people use radar as if its own word, and that's kind of become that way. But it is radio detection and ranging. Basically, it means that the electromagnetic waves get emitted from a sensor, it gets reflected off of a surface, and we use that information that gets reflected from the surface to tell us something about how far away that object is, what is the shape of that object, what are the material properties of that object. So we can use radar for this purpose. But the problem with radar is that the signal can fade very quickly. We also have very, you know, coarse resolution, very blurry looking images. And so what we can do is use this technology called SAR, Synthetic Aperture Radar. SAR is a radar system, so it's still radar, but it uses this Doppler shift to kind of give us a higher resolution repeat measurements of the same area. So it basically simulates a really, really long antenna. It like pretends that the antenna is 10 times longer than it actually is. But because of that, we get a much higher resolution image. So for the purpose of this talk, most of the data that I'm actually talking about is radar, is SAR data, but I'm just going to call it radar because that's the more conventional terminology. So radar remote sensing compared to optical remote sensing allows us the ability to image the Earth's surface day or night through clouds. And that's, again, very special because a lot of the optical methods, again, it's just like if you were standing outside with your phone. If it's very cloudy, then you're not going to be able to see as well. If it's dark, you're not going to be able to see as well. Radar does not care about those things. It's really interested in looking at the dielectric constant, or in this particular case, it's just the moisture content of the material and the geometry of the surface features. So which direction are the what are the orientations, what are the shapes, what are the sizes of the features? So this schematic here basically just demonstrates, and I'm sorry, I'm not sure how well you guys can see on this side. I'm like bending my head. So this figure here shows that for different look angles, so if the radar instrument is looking down and then looking over to the left, most of the radar instruments are either looking in one direction or looking in the other direction. It basically means that for a very smooth surface, like a mirror, you're going to get a really, really strong return. You're going to get a really strong signal. But as you look further away, the signal decreases quite a bit. So that's what this slope is showing, that that signal decreases as you're looking further away at a really smooth surface. But if the surface is very rough, that signal remains fairly constant at a lot of different incidence angles. But we also know that there's some differences between the polarizations of the incident wavelength as well as the shapes of the radar object of interest. So some of the radar frequencies that are used in remote sensing are just shown in this really simple table. So if you've ever heard someone say, like, X band this and this, P band that and that, basically it's just referring to a specific range of frequencies that might be used for that particular instrument. So one of the more commonly used ones are L band and C band. And actually just this morning there was a new satellite that was supposed to be launched and it blew up on the launch pad. So I'm very sad about that. So that was the L-band instrument that was meant to measure deformations around the globe as well as vegetation biomass. Most of the data that I'm focused on is the Ka-band, and that's relatively not well studied. So that's why I'm very excited to talk about Ka-band today. Another type of radar system is called an altimeter. Altimeters, if you break apart the word, it's for the altitude or the height of something, or the meter, so the measurement of the height of the thing. So if you're in space, you can actually measure the height of various objects. So there are satellite altimeters that enable global measurements of water surface elevation. The drawback to this is, as you can kind of see, this is an image of Lake Winnipeg. The spacing on this is around 12 kilometers. So it's really, really coarse. You get one measurement and you go, you know, 12 kilometers, you get another measurement. Because of that, you don't really get the high resolution detail. It also means that you can't resolve those smaller water bodies that I was talking about earlier. Satellite scatterometers are a different type of measurement, and those look at the roughness of the surface, and they can be used to actually retrieve wind speeds. So you can use satellite data to point at the water body and estimate how fast is the wind moving. We can also estimate what is the direction of the wind. So this image here shows this is the radar cross-section or the radar backscattering rate, but that is very well correlated with wind speed. So you can kind of see that each of these bands are different wind speeds or friction velocities. So again, the texture of the water surface itself. So you're not measuring the wind, you're measuring the texture of the water surface in response to the wind. And then this is the azimuthal direction. So what direction is the radar sensor actually looking at? So this is a picture of ASCAT scatterometer from METOP. This is the European Space Agency. And that is able to use this little spinning beam to assess the different roughness of the surface and assess what is the wind speed, what is the wind direction. SAR imagers are also commonly used for their ability to see beneath the water canopies, between the dense canopies of vegetation. So that's really nice. Again, I pointed out before the L band is around 24 centimeters all the way up to 90 centimeters. So that really means that it's able to look straight through the vegetation and see the water surface beneath that. So that's very interesting because the Ka band sensor that I also mentioned before can't do that. It's so small that it can't go through the vegetation. So a lot of this research is a bit older. This is from the early 2000s that basically say that, look, we can use radar data to retrieve the subcanopy profile, the subcanopy characteristics. But we have new radar satellites from Sentinel-6, NISAR, and SWAT. The Sentinel-6 mission was launched just in November 2022, and it has two altimeters, or two different radar frequencies on board, and that's used to measure the mean ocean surface height and significant wave height and wind speed. So that's really exciting because generally we don't have two higher frequency radar devices on the same instrument. It also has a radiometer that is able to measure the wet tropospheric path delay. And basically that is sensitive to the moisture that is in the troposphere. So that has very nice implications for us to be able to actually retrieve surface moisture in the atmosphere or humidity. So this was launched, as I mentioned, in 2020. And this is just an image of what the sea surface variations look like. So this is an anomaly product. So instead of just being able to retrieve the water surface directly, we're actually looking at a long-term average and saying, oh, this water surface is much lower here today than it normally is, or it's much higher here today than it normally is. And that's very important because that tells us something about what is the temperature of the water, what is the wind, and what are these other properties that are driving actual height variations in the water surface. So the shades of blue here are where the water surface is much lower, and the shades of red are where the water surfaces are much higher than normal. NISAR, NISAR stands for the NASA IRO, or the Indian Space Agency SAR mission. So it's going to be launched at the end of this year. That is the first satellite to use two different radar frequencies, the L band and S band. This is an imager, unlike the Sentinel-6, which I mentioned before, which is an altimeter. Both of these frequencies are able to penetrate the clouds and forest canopy, although the L band frequencies are able to penetrate deeper into the vegetation than the S band can. So they use the S band and L band for different purposes. But what's really interesting about this is that what a lot of people are very excited to do is use SAR in an INSAR mode. And what INSAR is interferometric SAR. So we're actually comparing the two different radar signals from day one to day two to get a change of the distances or how many phase changes. Oop, I just breathed in by myself. What is the phase changes between the two different imaging modes? And what's really interesting there is that some previous studies have demonstrated you get these really nice interferograms which tell you centimeter scale deformations that are happening. So this has really great implications for things like volcanoes. So if volcanoes might start to swell a little bit before they erupt. We also have evidence, this is an image of groundwater depletion. So if you're pumping a lot of water out of the ground, the ground will actually start sinking. So that has, we see that actually in quite a bit of regions around the world actually. So this is an example of what that would look like. We have a real decrease. So this is obviously an vertical exaggeration. Another product that NISAR is gonna be able to do is look at just the flooded region. So this is an area of Louisiana. We can see this is a water body, this little blob here in dark. And all of this yellow stuff is all flooded vegetation. And the pink stuff is dry. So we can use this to kind of get a sense of not just, oh, we can see very clearly that this is water, but we can actually look through the canopy and see that underneath the canopy it is wet as well. So the SWAT mission, this is what we really came here for. So the SWAT mission is the first of its kind SWAT mapper. So most of the instruments that I've discussed, again, are fairly coarse in spatial resolution. Particularly the Sentinel-6 mission that I mentioned is still on the scale of kilometers. This is going to give us a 50-meter spatial resolution, actually up to 10-meter spatial resolution. As I mentioned before, the look angle really matters. So if you're looking right here, you get a smaller spatial resolution. You're looking over there, you get a coarser spatial resolution. So it enables our monitoring of oceans and inland water bodies. So I'm not an oceanographer. I don't do a lot of that work, but I'm very excited about the signal that it's able to get. We can kind of treat both the oceans and the inland water bodies the same in terms of our ability to retrieve some of the surface processes. And so it's designed to help us estimate and predict the spatial variability of the terrestrial water storage. We do that over water bodies that are 250 meters in size, but 250 meters, and rivers that are wider than 100 meters. And so for inland hydrology, it's designed to have a very high spatial resolution, somewhere between 10 and 70 meters. And again, that is in stark contrast to the previous sensors that are around 12 kilometers. There's still kind of a question of its ability to be accurate, because the older systems are averaging over a much larger footprint, so you can get a smaller, you can get a more accurate average, whereas this one might actually be sensitive to a lot more noise. So because the measurements are in two dimensions and they cover a lot more land areas than the previous altimeters, new challenges have emerged. So what can we do about that? And again, I'm gonna double check my time. Okay, I'm good. What can we do from studying the airborne Ka-band radar? So the Ka-band radar is the radar that's used on SWAT. So are we ready for those data? Are we ready for those measurements? Is it going to work? So the SWAT satellite mission and its airborne component uses very high frequency Ka-band radar to measure the water surface elevation. So again, this uses the interferometric technology, or INSAR, to measure the elevation. So we have AirSWAT, and AirSWAT was flown in 2017. It was actually very recently flown around the Louisiana area. And it can be used to understand what SWAT observations might look like. So SWAT was just launched in December, but we're actually not going to get data available until this October. So we're still in preparation mode for some of the algorithms to be developed. So most of the data that I've been focusing on for the past few years is this little flight track here through Canada and Alaska. And in July 2017, we flew over 130 flight lines covering a very large area. Oh, wait, that started playing automatically. Excellent. So the AirSWAT platform enables a regional scale floodplain mapping and water level dynamics. This is an area called the Peace Athabasca Delta, where I do a lot of my field work. So again, that picture that I showed before was like me actually out in the field and measuring the wind speed, measuring the water levels in person. We can use that to calibrate our estimates from AirSWAT and then eventually our estimates from SWAT when that launched. And so in 2017, the flights across the above domain, the Canada-Alaska domain, revealed a really broad scale seasonal water level decline. And that was not guaranteed. So one of the things that some people were a little bit worried about with SWAT is that some of the AirSWAT data that we were seeing as it was coming down was extremely noisy. So some of the scientists who I was working with weren't even sure that they wanted to use it. They weren't sure that it was going to work. And so you can actually see all of these little points here. All of these little points are the actual AirSWAT measurements. And so earlier in the season, it's kind of it's pretty noisy, and later in the season, it's also fairly noisy. But what we can do is just take an average of these points and draw a local regression line through that. And that AirSWAT trend line, so the data that we've actually collected from multiple flights throughout the season, as compared to in the field measurements of water levels, we have these pressure transducers. That's what the PT stands for, these pressure transducers. We can look at all the pressure transducers and we can look at the trend line of the AirSWAT data. We could see that the AirSWAT data actually is telling us this broad scale water level decline. It's still very noisy, so if you want to look at this particular lake or that particular lake, it's not great. But if we want to aggregate over larger areas, this preliminary flight campaign was extremely promising. So it's great because, it's great because we can kind of assess that SWAT will perform even better because SWAT was a much more calibrated instrument. We're already starting to get data down, so we already know that it's working even better than AirSWAT. One of the other questions that we had was this ability to distinguish open water from wet land or vegetation. And so that's particularly important for SWAT's ability to measure water surface extent. So if you say the water surface extent is here or the volume is this much, then you need to know where the true water surface extent is, otherwise your water balance is going to be incorrect. But one of the things that we've found is that some of the expectation for where the open water is, where we were actually walking on the field and saying this is where the water body is, the radar data showed that the signal here looks like water too. And so we did this transect out into this, this is a Paiute Pond, this right around Edwards Air Force Base. We can see, you can tell that this is pretty dry land, but it has little wet spots in it. And when we do a simple comparison of the radar backscatter measurement, that's this gray line here, and the soil moisture measurements here in green, we can see that they actually are pretty well correlated. So visual assessments of Ka band observations and comparisons with field data identified much brighter scattering over wet soils than we expected. And again, that might be a little bit problematic when we're trying to get a good assessment of where is the total water surface extent. This is what some of the imagery actually looks like. So this is a really fun thing. We can actually see what some of the SWOT data might actually look like. And what's great about this is you can actually see this is an area around Smoky Lake in Alberta, Canada, where we can identify all of these different crop fields. And you can tell these different tonal variations because it's related, to the geometry of the field. So what type of crop is growing here, we can start seeing that. We can also tell how much water is happening on that field. There's a big lake right here, though. And what's kind of interesting, you might see that there's some tonal variations. This whole thing is the lake, but this part of the lake looks different from this part of the lake. And that's because there's a lot of emergent vegetation that's happening over here, and then over here is where there's a lot of open water, but you also see the streaking effect, and that's related to the wind. So there's a lot of this different signal being convolved into one. If we want to get a good assessment of what is the true open water extent, we have to be able to break apart all these pieces. So some of the work that I did was to assess the moisture base or dielectric contributions, the Ka band scattering, and the vegetation water content. So it's an entire gradient of wet vegetation to fully open water. So we're able to identify that backscatter increases with increasing moisture. That's kind of what we expected because we know that it has some sensitivity to moisture. When we break that down on an individual land cover basis, that signal is not so clear. So we have to go a step further and say, well, maybe there's some more structural geometric component associated with that. I'm just going to skip that part. So the other part of the study that I did was to look at the vegetation structure and the orientation contributions. So this image here on the right just shows a forest stand, and then this is a LIDAR data that tells us the height or the relative density of the vegetation. It's actually called complexity of the vegetation. So we compare the vegetation complexity with the LIDAR data, with the radar data. So here we have the radar backscatter information, so how strong is the signal strength from the radar, and then how complex is the vegetation. We can actually see that for a lot of vegetation that the signal decreases as complexity increases. That's not too surprising as well because the radar electromagnetic beams are actually going into the canopy and they're not actually able to come back out. So it's particularly interesting because the Ka band is thought to not be able to penetrate canopies, but there are gaps in the canopy that we still need to accommodate for. So a lot of the radar scattering models assume that canopies are like this closed envelope that the Ka band cannot get through, but in fact, that's not the case. So another part of my research looked at the effects of wind speed. So I showed that diagram before that showed this streaking across the water surface, and I wanted to be able to see if we can use this radar instrument to retrieve wind speeds. And as I pointed out earlier, the scatterometers are capable of retrieving wind speed, but SWOT is not a scatterometer. It's not designed to retrieve wind speed at all. But I wanted to see what the sensitivity was, so I just wanted to try. And one of the things that I found was that, again, this is a radar backscatter here, this is wind speed here, this is a coherence measurement, so this is the coherence is a measure of how well does the interferogram work or how well are we able to retrieve the water surface elevations. And we found that there's a sensitivity to the wind speed, and therefore there's a sensitivity in our ability to retrieve the appropriate water surface elevation. So we're not going to be able to get good water surface elevations if the wind speeds don't reach 3 meters per second, actually. Which is kind of good news, because the global average wind speeds are around 3 meters per second. So we can say that on average, we will get the right amount of signal in order to get the good water surface elevations back. But we also know that this is climatically varying and regionally varying. So there's some areas where we're not going to be able to retrieve wind speeds, and we're not going to be able to retrieve the water surface elevations. Therefore, we're not going to be able to do our water balance studies correctly. And there's other areas where we will consistently always get very good measurements. So backscatter in coherence, or again, coherence is a measurement of how well does the signal perform, increase with increasing wind speed with optimal values around 15 dB. So that's the signal strength for water classification, so our ability to get the accurate water surface extent. And for water surface retrieval, when winds are greater than 3 meters per second, that's just for translation's sake, that's around 6.7 miles per hour or 10.8 kilometers per hour. So just kind of taking it back to why is this important? It's because some of the remaining sources of error in our ability to monitor and assess water availability are in the accurate assessment of surface water and surface moisture. So most of the stuff that I talked about today was focused on surface water. And so what's going to be able to revolutionize our ability to monitor changes to surface water storage by providing high spatial and temporal resolution assessments of water storage change? But the work that I've done also shows that not only is SWOT going to be able to look at water surface water storage change and discharge, but it can actually do a lot more. So not only is it going to be able to track water storage change, but it's also going to be able to help us characterize surface texture and actually be able to retrieve some of the canopy information. So again, looking at just a superficial layer of the canopy and some of the crop types. We'll also be able to have an improved ability to map floodplains and surface moisture dynamics, as well as to retrieve wind speed. So again, SWOT was not designed to retrieve wind speed at all, but we can use it to retrieve wind speed. So that really optimizes and actually triples the amount of parameters and the amount of data that SWOT is actually going to be able to produce for scientific study. So, yeah, I'm good. How can you get involved in remote sensing research? Because I know you guys are all very excited to just get involved and start doing this. So there's a lot of programs that I think are great. One of them is called the NASA Applied Remote Sensing Training, or called ARSET. They have free online trainings. A lot of those trainings are around 8 hours long. They are accessible to a wide range of audience, so I do just encourage you to just go to the website and see what's there. There's also a NASA Develop program. I was involved in NASA Develop for about 3 years when I first started my work with NASA Goddard in Maryland. So this is a paid internship, a contract position, so they will allow high school students, college students, graduate students, early career, ex-military. So it's really an engine to get new people interested in remote sensing. Just go to YouTube. That's a good option. I think a lot of people are already familiar with just checking YouTube to learn more. There's really nice tutorials that are available that are published by NASA and by NSF for how to use the NASA data and how to access that. So those are the official tutorials, but there's also individual contributors. I'm actually working on building up my own lab and providing tutorials for how to access some of the more complicated radar and LIDAR data. But I also encourage you to just email a researcher, email a professor, email a teacher, email someone you know who is involved in research and ask them what kind of projects do they have. Maybe they might not be able to fund you or to support you, but they might be able to give you some recommendations for what you might who you might work with and what type of projects that you might be working on. There's also really interesting citizen science projects. So it might be that instead of me going out in the field, I tell the citizens of the land to go out and take some measurements for me and report it to the website. And that's really fun because you can get involved and I can get my measurements and everyone's happy. And again, the last item is just to contribute to a lab. So this might be a paid or unpaid position. You might get course credit, depending on the availabilities of the lab. So I highly recommend that. So the last slide, I just want to say NASA has a very excellent applied remote sensing program. Most of the stuff that I talked about today is water resources. This is the Nature of Water Conference. But they also have a lot of non-water related things. So if you're still interested in applied earth science and you're trying to figure out exactly where do you fit into that, They have a lot of things such as capacity building, which is really interesting because it allows you to work with communities and say, this is how, you know, water or air quality or, you know, fill in the blank is affecting your community. That's capacity building. You're actually training other people to know what you know. You're also, also disasters, water resources, agriculture, climate resilience, health and air quality, ecological conservation, and wildland fires. So there's a really broad range of activities that NASA is involved in that you can get involved in as well. So you can really just go online right now and say, I want to get involved in NASA activities, and you'll very likely be able to participate in some form. So I just wanted to let you know that that is all available for you. So thank you. I would like to say thank you especially to Lori for inviting me here. I'd like to thank you, the organizing committee, for hosting me here, and I'm excited to be able to share my research. Thank you.